It's been a year now since I dug a huge hole in my backyard and hoisted a 12-foot diameter tube through the air to submerge it underground, turning the unused real estate below my grass into a large culvert bunker. However, air doesn't quite flow the same way below ground as it does above ground. We know that the CO2 we exhale is heavier than regular air and can displace the oxygen, which I'm told is important. Lack of oxygen could lead to my asphyxiation, which would make my wife mad, and nobody wants that. Playing around deep holes is rather dangerous. Back in the day, they would bring literal canaries down into the coal mines to let the miners know if it was dangerous or not. If the birds got sick or died, the miners would know it was time to leave the mines. My local pet shop wouldn't sell me any live canaries, so we've just been blowing air into both the entrances to make sure there's enough circulation that we have the oxygen we need. But I'm pretty sure that method is overkill. Today we've hooked up legitimate air monitoring sensors, and we're gonna see if 3 people working down here for the day is enough to move the CO2 meter or the oxygen meter. OSHA says any level below 19.5 is dangerous, and currently we're sitting above 20, which is very normal for outside air. And our CO2 meter should stay below 2,000 parts per million, and so far we're fine. Today we're also gonna try to find a way to condition the air. Since down here it sits at a pretty hoodie-worthy 50 degrees continuously, it's consistently cozy down here, and we're gonna try to warm it up a bit.
The heater we'll be installing doubles as an AC unit. It's EcoFlow's most powerful portable heat pump called the Wave 3. We'll also be building out the kitchen, since we gotta multitask if we wanna finish before winter, or before civilization collapses, whichever comes first. Being underground is interesting, because even during the most brutal parts of a Utah winter, when it's below freezing outside, the bunker doesn't get colder than 40 degrees. And in the hottest parts of summer, when it's almost 100 degrees above ground, the bunker peaks at a relatively cool 60 degrees Fahrenheit. Livable for sure, but adding some heat would make it more cozy. However, heat requires either fuel or energy, both of which, in an actual apocalyptic scenario, we'd have a limited supply of either, especially this far underground. We're using insulated ducting to hopefully help preserve some of the heat that we create as we pipe it through the bunker. Eventually, we'll probably have to insulate the walls of the bunker itself, or stock up on a bunch of good-looking sweaters. Now that we have the cylindrical bunker in the ground, we realize that one of the biggest problems that we have is that the bunker is cylindrical, which means that every single piece for the cabinetry that we have to cut has some kind of radius attached to it.
Hey, that's not bad. Nice work.
We've taken the general diameter of the circle and used a string and a permanent marker, which will hopefully get us close enough.
It's currently 53 degrees down here.
We're trying to use as much reclaimed material as possible. Like, we had 2 avenues that we could take when building out this underground bunker. We could make it super premium and super nice, or we could use like recycled wood. I'll show you what the countertop looks like in a second. The slats you're seeing now are actually scrap wood left over from our wooden hand rims at the wheelchair factory. We also just snagged these pre-built cabinets from Home Depot to speed up the counter making process. For obvious reasons, we can't light any kind of fire to stay warm down here. We could use an old school electric resistive heater, where for every 1 watt of electricity, we get 1 watt worth of heat. However, nowadays with our more advanced human technology, we have something called a heat pump, which has a 1-to-3 energy ratio, meaning for every watt of energy that goes in, I get 3 watts worth of heat energy coming back out. It just so happens that EcoFlow makes the most powerful portable air conditioner on the market, called the EcoFlow Wave 3. Normally this unit is used for tent camping, car camping, or small RVs, but we're gonna try it out here in the bunker. 660 watts of electricity goes in, but 2000 watts worth of heat comes out, thanks to that 1-to-3 energy conversion we get using the phase change of the internal R290 refrigerant. There are two parts to the EcoFlow Wave 3. There's the front part, which acts as like the air handler inside of your house, and then there's the back half that acts as the AC unit that sits outside of your house. My arm is rested on the power button, and it's turning on. Which is perfect timing because it can output both hot and cold air from this vent here. So if you're just trying to warm up a tent or a single room outside your RV, pipe this into your window and you're good to go. However, if you have it set up in a more permanent area, like we do here inside of the bunker, turning it back off, ooh, this is nice and warm. Then you have to do something with the exhaust air, which is back here. We have to have an external intake and an external... We have an external intake and an external exhaust because a heat pump just moves heat around and there's always gonna be air of the opposite temperature you want that you have to get rid of. The Wave 3 is only IPX4, so it should only be outside if it's not raining.
I know I said lighting a fire in a bunker is a bad thing, except for at this specific moment, we need some fire, or better said, plasma, from a plasma torch to punch ventilation holes for our heat pump into the entryway.
We cut the large conduit holes with a plasma cutter to eject out the excess air into the elevator shaft, while just circulating the interior air to be warmed up inside of the bunker. The plasma cutter is running off of the 240 volts from the EcoFlow Delta Pro 3. A little bit smoky right now. I think Nate's catching the cabinets on fire. But we've been keeping track of the CO2, like parts per million down here. We have these little air valent air sensors and it tells us right now it's 545 parts per million of CO2. And even after three people being down here all day long, it's almost 5 p.m., we're still at 50 degrees. The e-ink display though is pretty cool. The lowest temperature that the Wave 3 can operate at is 41 degrees. So even during the winter, when it's the coldest down here, we still should be able to use the heat pump to warm up the space. The vents below the floor will help distribute the air coming out of the unit. The Wave 3 is only circulating the air inside of the bunker and not bringing in fresh air, so fresh air is a problem for another day. But so far our CO2 and oxygen levels are still in the safe zones. We also don't have doors at either end of the bunker, so that facilitates the airflow a bit, but the doors again are a problem for future Jerry to solve. This can run without a battery, just plugging it directly into the wall, but we have the external battery below, which can also be charged up with 400 watts of solar. That battery gives it about 8 hours of runtime, but since it's plugged in permanently inside of the bunker, and we have solar panels over the bunker hatch, it can pretty much run indefinitely down here. This can be controlled and remotely monitored by an app, but it does not need an app or the internet or the grid to even function, which makes it perfect for the bunker. EcoFlow gave us a 5% discount for the Wave 3 if you buy before May 25th, and I'll leave that code down in the video description. For the countertops, we want to do something a little more special, and recycling an old basketball court from Tent View High School here in Utah sounds pretty fun. We got this board for $30 off of Facebook Marketplace, and I don't think anyone's made a countertop out of a basketball court before, but it should be an interesting project. You know what the top of a basketball court looks like, but on the underside there's support boards here and little rubber feet. These help cushion, you know, the people playing basketball on top. Either way, those parts have to come off for the countertop. Again, we decided to use technology from the future for the stovetop. Gas stoves are about 40% efficient and wouldn't work in our bunker anyway. Traditional electric coil style burners are 75% efficient, which is fine, but induction stovetop burners, like the one we are installing, are 90% efficient. And using induction means we will use up less of our battery bank and solar panels when we prepare our macaroni and cheese. Michael Jordan ain't the only one cooking on this basketball court.
I'll see myself out.
It is made here in the USA, though.
Now it's going underground. Induction does require a steel or stainless steel pan, though. If a magnet doesn't stick to it, it probably doesn't work for induction. Remember, we're gonna have a 100-inch TV going right here at some point. And now with the kitchen and the sink and the stovetop all finished, you might be like, hey Jerry, but what are you gonna do for a fridge? And I'm glad you asked. We haven't got a permanent fridge yet, but temporarily, for the sake of efficiency, we're using the EcoFlow Glacier, which is a new portable fridge and freezer combo that has a divider inside that can keep food frozen on one half and chilled on the other half, like a fridge, for up to 43 hours before reverting itself back into just a regular cooler. It's cool that it can do both at the same time, which is great for the apocalypse or, you know, a road trip. It has an optional internal battery, where you can add 110 watts worth of solar so it can stay cool indefinitely. And my favorite part is that it can be opened from either side. EcoFlow is offering the same 5% discount on the portable fridge if you order before May 25th, and I will leave that link in the video description. Doing a quick heat test with the Wave 3, it's currently outputting 114 degrees Fahrenheit. And we have a thermal camera that can get a reading on each of the vents. We have 90 degrees Fahrenheit coming out of that vent in the ground. We have 85, 86 degrees coming out of that vent. And then back here in the master bedroom, another 90 degrees worth of temperature coming out of that vent. And just for kicks and giggles, let's look at what we have mounted to the wall. The inverter has heat coming out of the top. That's the control panel with our DC fuses. The oxygen reader, that's cool. Thermal cameras are fun. To be fair, the Wave 3 is built to handle a room about 150 square feet, and we have about 500 here, four times larger than it's meant to handle. So we're probably going to just turn off the vents and have it do one room at a time, because we're surrounded by 1 million pounds worth of earth, and it's like trying to warm up an active refrigerator. As for our oxygen readouts, I have bad news. Our PPMs are getting up to 1700, which is not good. So we do have to find some fresh air intake or turn the fans back on. But our oxygen is staying maintained right around 20.7. And I don't think that's gonna move a bit, but the PPMs, the CO2 is an issue. So we're gonna kick on the fans next time we're down here. Honestly, I think we've built a pretty impressive bunker, but it's EcoFlow who's turning the space into a livable place. Get a 5% discount off of your own EcoWave or EcoGlacier Classic. I'll leave a link for that down in the description. And we still have to figure out the water situation for the sink, as well as the special combustible toilet. So make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss that project. And thanks a ton for watching. I'll see you around.